Good afternoon and welcome to today's episode of Scala's Love of Learning Live. I want to welcome all of you today. And before I introduce our distinguished guest, I want to ask those of you who are signing on, just if you want, please go ahead and drop a note in the chat box. I would love to know who we have here with us today. I know people have signed up from all across the United States. People have signed up from Europe. We have students here, we have educators, we have parents. So if you wanna drop a quick note in the chat box letting us know your name and where you're logging in from today. Scala is a nonprofit that I started with the objective of reinvigorating an understanding of classical liberal arts education grounded in an anthropology that sees the person as created for freedom by God. Scala sponsors events for students in Princeton, where I teach at the Princeton Theological Seminary. Scala also runs a summer program called Rediscovering Integral Humanism, where we talk about foundational questions in philosophy of education and try to think about educational practices that integrate mind, body, and soul of the student. Scala also hosts conferences on various topics related to the human person and education. And our in-person events have been so successful that during this time of COVID, when we are mostly at home, we decided to bring some of our online conversations, some of our conversations online to viewers all across the United States and abroad. I'm delighted today to welcome Tim O'Malley, who is the Director of Education at the McGrath Institute for Church Life at the University of Notre Dame. The McGrath Institute for Church Life seeks to be a bridge between the academy and the church. The Institute also publishes the Church Life Journal, where I have had the honor of publishing several articles in recent years. I encourage all of you to check out the many resources from the McGrath Institute for Church Life at the University of Notre Dame. Follow the Church Life Journal on Facebook, read their articles. I'm also delighted to have the co-sponsorship today of the McGrath Institute, as well as the co-sponsorship of the Pepperdine School of Public Policy. I'd like to thank my friend Pete Peterson, the Dean of the School of Public Policy at Pepperdine, for agreeing to co-sponsor this event. You should also follow Pete and the American Project that he runs at Pepperdine. Follow them on Twitter and Facebook. They're doing amazing work, and I will actually be teaching a class on humanizing educational philosophy and practice for the Pepperdine School of Public Policy and their summer program in Washington, D.C. So I'm so grateful to have these partnerships with the McGrath Institute and with Pepperdine. So welcome, thank you everybody who has let us know in the chat box where you are, where you're coming here from today. And I will just say a brief note about the format and then we'll jump in. This is going to be a dialogue between me and Tim. It's actually great to do this dialogue with Tim online because I think before we met in person, Tim and I had interacted online through Twitter and Facebook because we share a lot of the same content and discovered that we both have a passion for educational philosophy and educational renewal with an openness to questions of transcendence. And so when I met Tim in person, it took me a while to connect kind of who he was and, you know, put it all together because we had this friendship online. So now we're gonna have this conversation online about experiential education in John Dewey and Luigi Giussani. The conversation between Tim and I will last for about 45 minutes. We will take questions from the audience. We're scheduled to go until 4, but if it's possible, I'll try to keep us online a little longer because I think we're gonna have a lot of questions today. You can put your questions, please, in the Q&A box. In the chat box, I've asked people to introduce themselves. I've also asked Michael Paul, who works with Scala, to put some resources for further reading in the chat box as we go along. So, now to start the dialogue. Tim, welcome, and thank you for being here today.
Well, thanks so much for having me. It's nice to be together and see you face-to-face rather than, you know, just on Twitter.
A little bit more face-to-face. At least you see
That's right. It's closer.
Not my meme. Okay. Well, Tim, just could you introduce yourself to the audience, not just, you know, your academic bio, which is really impressive, but tell us a little bit about yourself, your own education, and specifically how you came to study John Dewey.
Yeah, so I grew up in Maryville, Tennessee, and then when it was time to leave to go to college, I went to the University of Notre Dame for my bachelor's degree in theology and philosophy. And while at Notre Dame, I grew very interested in liturgical studies, like the study of liturgy. And I remember my senior year, I happened upon a book that I know has been important to these conversations, Jean Leclerc's The Love of Learning and the Desire for God. And I kind of came for myself to the central insight that would guide a good deal of my scholarship, is that there's a connection between prayer and the life of worship, and the connection also between learning and the desire to know. I ended up doing a master's degree in liturgical studies at Notre Dame, focusing on this, but I came to realize that the thing that interests me was the interrelationship between educational theory, what it means to learn, together with theology. And so I left Notre Dame to do my doctorate at Boston College. And there at Boston College, I sort of really encountered Dewey for the first time, primarily because he was so taught in the areas of religious education. He was the founder of the Religious Education Association, argued for a broader inclusion of religious education in public life, although his conception, as we'll see today, of religion was a bit strange. And so I began to study Dewey almost as a way, I was like very sympathetic to much of what Dewey says about education, right? Education is not simply being a throwing of content into the head of the student, that it has to have something to do with life and with existence. And so I was attracted to Dewey, and yet at the same time, problems with his understanding of metaphysics, of the human person, of a kind of his own conception of religion as a whole, I often found him as an interlocutor that I had to deal with. And so I did my actual work on St. Augustine as offering a kind of distinctive model of education grounded in worship, radically different from Dewey. And then continued on sort of understanding these figures. And then eventually when I got to the University of Notre Dame to teach and to work as work in the McGrath Institute, I began to teach officially theology and education for our undergraduates and for our graduate students. And I return again, in essence, to this fight that I've had with Dewey about a proper diagnosis, but an improper prescription that he offered. And at the same time here, I discovered other figures who I found a better answer to the solution, including that of Luigi Giussani. And so that's where I am today. And I would say that, you know, the trajectory was a strange one because it led from the study of worship to education and together, but I think it's what I try to keep together in all my work.
That's fascinating. Okay, let's back up a little bit because you said something that I think is really where we should start. You said that there's a lot to like in John Dewey, and I chose the title of this webinar as Experiential Education because that's probably the concept that Dewey is most known for. And I would have to say at the outset, I agree with you. There are some deeper issues with Dewey, but before we get to that, let's talk about what is Dewey's idea of experiential education, which has been probably his most enduring legacy. What is Dewey saying that experiential education is, and why is it so significant?
Yeah, so I suspect that one of the problems with how we interpret experience in Dewey is the assumptions that people bring to it, right? So we envision a school in the luscious hills of Vermont where people are given a guitar and maybe a rock and they figure out together how to like understand music and count and eventually develop calculus. Like Dewey, that is not Dewey's idea of experiential education. And in experience in education, he rips this apart, right? Experiential education is simply that human beings are learn best by actually working and engaging in the world. They experience the world. And so for Dewey, you work with the world, you solve problems. The world presents you with problems. And an education that pretends that you don't think or work with those problems will lead to a kind of traditionalism where sort of ideas are merely passed on for no reason, or it will reserve these ideas exclusively for an elite, right? If you're an elite person, you deserve to know this, but if you are to work in a factory, you don't. So why worry about it? And so he reacts against this, that every human being, by their makeup, by how they engage the world as a living creature, a live creature, engages in the world as a kind of experiment. I mean, really, experiential learning for Dewey is experimental learning. We try to figure things out. We're faced with a problem and we try to solve it. And the educator sets up the classroom as a space that allows people to solve problems rather than simply to receive information, which the educator does have to do, right? So any person thinking needs information. They need to understand something so that they can try to solve the problem, but the goal is the solving of the problem. And so I would say that's a proper understanding of experiential education. And it's one that to a certain extent, you will even find Jacques Maritain allowing for and affirming, right? That there's a gift to this above that of an education that treats students as rocks themselves that you throw in classrooms and yell at and sort of speak to. So I'd say that's the positive sense of experiential education briefly for Dewey.
I have to admit, I was laughing when you said that Dewey's version of experiential education isn't like going to a mountain in Vermont with a guitar and a rock and expecting people to figure out calculus by themselves, right? So Dewey's version of experiential education was actually different than other people at his time who didn't actually think teachers mattered and who didn't think that content really mattered at all. So Dewey had more, his version of experiential education was trying to bring together what people are learning with experimenting, with practicing things. And he was reacting to a version of a traditional education that was pure rote memorization, kind of like kids lined up in a row, being fed facts that they just have to memorize cold, right? So Dewey in some ways was trying to strike a middle ground between this almost ridiculous image of if you give kids a guitar and a rock, they'll figure out calculus, and this very rigid kind of traditionalist education where the student's experience isn't relevant at all to what they're learning. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's right. And he saw the sort of scientific method is integral to this. You know, education is not a sort of happenstance of either just passing on a body of knowledge or a kind of sudden explosion that happens if you just put the right things in place. The teacher could be trained, formed to actually understand what was happening, educate on purpose than rather by accident, and set up the classroom to achieve certain aims or objectives by the setting up of the right environment for the sake of learning. And so you could kind of see him taking a scientific methodology and you really from sort of experimental science and throwing it into the classroom for the first time.
Okay, great. So, and that, as you pointed out, in, for example, Jacques Maritain's book, Education at the Crossroads, he says that there is a lot to be admired in this version of experiential education. However, Maritain also says, and I've heard you say, that there's also a deeper problem here in how Dewey's form of experiential education is framed. And what does Dewey say about the role of religion in education? For example,
Dewey tends to be quite, there's a sort of irony of Dewey's own religious background. And part of it is historical. Dewey grew up as a Congregationalist in Vermont. He attended the University of Vermont, where his sort of, he took upon himself a kind of religious vision informed by Hegel. He studied with philosophers who were Hegelians and saw a kind of Hegelian religiosity to the world. He would further study Hegel at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, but then was placed, his first job was at the University of Michigan, which had been formed as one of the first non-sectarian institutions in the United States for higher learning, which incidentally never saw religion entirely separate. They wanted religious education, theological education, for lack of a better word, to take place in the local parishes or congregations. So Dewey gave a series of lectures while he was at the University of Michigan, in which his primary focus was on teaching these Congregationalists a kind of Hegelian vision of Christianity, sort of translating Christianity into Hegel.
Can you talk for a moment and tell our listeners who may not be really strong on Hegel? Sorry about that.
No problem. Oh, is that good?
Sorry for that interruption. Okay, could you explain to our listeners who may not be familiar with Hegel why it's so significant that Dewey was drawing on a Hegelian understanding of history?
Well, yeah, so I mean, part of it is history, right? So to start with, he is drawing from a conception of a Christianity that's moving beyond the particulars of doctrine, right? Particular doctrinal claims, and more to the level of sort of statements of truth. You know, something like the resurrection as a non-historical reality, but that really what it ultimately is, the resurrection in its fullness, is the principle that all of life shall be redeemed and resurrected, right? So that there's a rationalism that the resurrection in all of its supernatural weirdness has to be dismissed, and what's left behind is philosophy adjudicates what's really rational about the resurrection. And this comes to be linked then also to what the church is, right? So the church is not the gathering of those who are solely interested in salvation. The church becomes the community of those who gather the social entity that passes on this religiosity, that lives it out, and the overly superstitious dimensions of religion have to disappear. And that actually, you know, later Dewey, when he goes to the University of Chicago and takes up a philosophy position and starts up a school that does workshop, that's really sort of the first workshop school, a kind of space that was designed to teach kids. He leaves religion behind for years, for the most part, in his own thinking, until he returns only later in his art as experience and his common faith, so that faith becomes more, the particulars of Christian faith were simply a preparation for the faith of America. This faith in a democratic principle that if we all worked together well and came together well and engaged in common inquiry together, then human beings could become one, right? So there was this, we could make a better world. And this is the real faith of America. This is what Christianity has always been leading to. And dogmatism, particular doctrines, are to be left behind for what's authentic, which is this movement ever higher and higher towards unity, towards oneness.
All right, so if I heard you correctly, Dewey himself was raised in a religious household, was affiliated for a time as a Congregationalist, worked in a Congregationalist environment, but then left behind religion, only to rediscover it later because of his interest in perhaps art. But when he talks about religion in his book, A Common Faith, which is perhaps less widely read than his works on education, he says pretty clearly, really unequivocally, that he's reached the conclusion that any of the supernatural claims about religion are untrue, and that what we need to keep are the values that arise from religion, but not the doctrines and not the creeds. Is that right?
Yes, I mean, absolutely. And so what's left behind is this kind of principle of philosophical wisdom that religion teaches, that religion teaches you to be contemplative, to pay attention to things. It has a wisdom and a morality to it that's worth attending to. In essence, Dewey is not unique on this. I mean, he's simply taken up the modern critique and sort of understanding of religion, what Hansers von Balthasar calls the kind of cosmological reduction, where all that's left is these sort of universal truths that would have been accessible to reason unto itself. And so he's taken that up and he's followed it through to his end.
Okay, so Dewey was not really unlike a lot of other philosophers of modernity who saw something good in religion in the name of the values that it promoted and the ideas of justice and care for the poor. But he's pretty clear that this claim that there is a transcendent God who became man and resurrected from the dead, like, that's really not true for Dewey. And he says that the problem is, he even calls it an illusion, a projection, right? And he tries to explain the persistence of these supernatural beliefs or creeds as a human psychological projection, right? God and these rituals and beliefs are a projection of human psychology. And if we were to know and apply his method of education and his view of democracy, we would no longer need to have these transcendent supernatural beliefs in order to have the values and the justice and the equality. Is that a fair assessment?
Yeah, the society that progresses no longer needs them, right? It had a role, it served its purpose, and now we've come to this new era where we leave behind the institution and the particulars of doctrine for what comes ahead. And that's the, this of course is the great temptation of modern sort of philosophical interpretation of religious doctrine as a whole, right? It claims nothing beyond truth that can be left behind, and now let's move ahead. And so, but of course, this proves to be one, untrue. One, people still believe these things, and they believe them not simply as illusions. So that's the problem that Dewey has to deal with. And two, it is a desire to rationalize religious faith, to rationalize everything, an over-rationalization. I think, you know, Dewey is friends with William James, and they sort of operate within a kind of pragmatism. Think about the varieties of religious experience and by William James. Could a mystical thing be real? Well, yes, but its realness is psychological, right? It, you know, you have to have, you have to understand it in a mode of something that finds it acceptable according to that which is rational. And it can exist unto itself as a mystery to be encountered, as something that reason alone, or at least a kind of scientific reason, cannot fully grasp.
Okay, so look, the appeal to Dewey is obvious. And, you know, I wanted to have this webinar on Dewey because I think a lot of people listening today or a lot of people in the general public may not know what an enduring influence he had, right? Dewey published widely. He was very influential in public policy, extremely influential in education. There are probably like 40 books written about Dewey's thought and hundreds of articles. So Dewey's influence has been enormous. And I think when I read a lot of assessments of Dewey, these subtler points are often left out. And one of them being what I'm about to raise right now. I mean, part of what I think people find appealing in Dewey is the experiential education, as we talked about, but also his claim that we can learn everything we need to know without making any kind of what he calls non-rational presuppositions about the existence of God or these supernatural claims. So for Dewey, his idea of knowledge of how we know things or what we can know is purely scientific. Everything we can know, we can learn from the scientific method, and we need no presuppositions. Is that correct, what he claims, that Dewey says this?
I mean, I think it's somewhat, yeah. I would say that to small nuance to the claim is that all thinking for Dewey operates in its most full form according to the dictates of the scientific method. We first gather information, we then develop a hypothesis, we go about and we test that hypothesis is true or not, we make a judgment upon it, we change our action and move along with that, and then we begin the process over again. But of course, anyone who's ever fallen in love, who's ever, faced suffering or death or evil, know that there are just certain things in life that's not how things function, right? Mm-hmm. When you're falling in love, you're not like, well, let's gather the data of this beloved. Who are they? What is that they offer for me? What is evident? I mean, there's something more there that cannot simply be taken account through this scientific method unto itself, right? Thinking is more than the scientific method. The scientific method can show you the interrelationship between things that are perceivable. But for most of Western history, there have been things that are not perceivable. And whether you're talking about in sort of Platonic thought, Aristotelian thought, there are things that you cannot see, that cannot be perceived, that you cannot measure. And if all of thinking is measurable, as Dewey seems to say, then it doesn't leave a space necessarily for not like romanticism, which is also has its own problems, but that for which scientific reason alone cannot explain.
Okay, so let me put it this way. Dewey talks a lot about psychology. Does Dewey have the concept of the person of having something we might call a soul, or?
No, not at least certainly as the Western tradition has determined it. He rejects all sort of body, soul. In essence, Dewey continually rejects what he calls dualisms, body, soul, mind, matter. And while this rejection of this dualism has benefits, it means that he often sort of eviscerates a good chunk of the interior life. Everything is lived in the exterior. So our mind isn't an interior part of ourselves in any way, shape, or form. There's no something like a kind of interior soul or the interior work of memory, imagination. All of this is exclusively in interaction with the physical, tangible world.
Okay. All right, so I mean, I bring that up because I think what's significant for Dewey is that what that needs to be pointed out is that his view of who we are as a human person is fundamentally different than what someone like Jacques Maritain or Luigi Giussani, who we're gonna talk about next, would say, right? Because for someone like Maritain or Giussani, we are mind, body, and soul, we're a unity, but there's this piece of us in the soul that's capable of having intuition and an experience of God, a kind of mystical experience. And for Dewey, mystical experiences might happen, but they're kind of an aberration. You can't explain them, and they certainly don't lead you to anything that's true or good. So Dewey's really trying to get to a vision of human nature and the human good that's excluding the soul and excluding any kind of mystical experiences or any kind of contemplation. Is that right?
Well, it's not there in spades. And I think that there's a kind of generic sort of contemplation of the natural order, and you find it in art and experience where he really is, or sort of art as experience rather, where he does speak about this contemplative dimension later in his career, but there's not the conception of the person as having an interior self that is different than just living out in the world, right? So it's not about action or movement, that there's something, there's no sort of Augustinian, that there's something that you don't even know about yourself, right? This inescapable more that's to be human. And I really think it is the kind of embracing of a philosophy that reduces religion and everything, social practice, the memory of a society, to nothing but like dictates of rational memories that have been passed on from age to age. And when you have that, there's not room for this interior life, for authentic personhood, like you find, I think, more richly in Giussani.
Well, that's a great segue. I think it's now time to talk a little bit about Luigi Giussani and how his views on education, how his views on the human person are similar, but also I think different from Dewey. And perhaps by putting these two great thinkers together in the same panel, we can see the strengths and weaknesses and differences of them. So could you tell us briefly just who Giussani is and how you came to study Giussani?
Yeah, so my setting of Giussani was nearly accidental. I was doing a directed readings when I first arrived back at Notre Dame on education and Christianity. And we were studying the sort of full tradition. We were reading Augustine and Gregory of Nyssa, and we read Thomas Aquinas, Bonaventure. And the students asked for something a bit more modern, and they asked for Luigi Giussani's The Risk of Education. And so I began to read it. And at last, I think I found in Giussani the kind of conception of experience that actually did respond to the needs of the human person for a world that actually existed out there somewhere, that we live life, that you can't just tell someone, for example, that God became human and in Christ, and that they're immediately going to have their lives changed. They actually have to deal with that. They have to, you know, there's the risk of actually figuring that out. It's not purely scientific. and that education is this risk where one proposes to the student a hypothesis through one's life, through the tradition, through an authority, and you have to kind of try that out and live that out. And there is a kind of experimental dimension to this, but it's an experimental dimension grounded in a communion and a community, living a concrete form of life together, grounded in a person who is Jesus. And so I found there, like, okay, this is better. And then I began to teach and read all of Giussani's works, right? So I would teach the religious sense and teach, I began to teach other dimensions of Giussani's work to students, because I found that it helped them to think anew about a way of teaching, particularly Christianity, today.
Well, that's great. You know, I also came to read Giussani rather, you know, many years into my career as a professor, where I've been teaching for a long time. I began to read Giussani after finishing a three-year project on philosophy of social science. So my formal training is in psychology and sociology. And I did an entire project trying to talk about philosophy of the human person in the social sciences. And what I encountered again and again was that philosophy of the human person in the social sciences really wanted to stop at psychology. It didn't really want to talk about the soul. It didn't want to talk about transcendence. It didn't want to talk about mystery. And it didn't want to talk about any kind of truth that couldn't ultimately be subjected to the scientific method, right? So everything about the human person that we should say should be subject to the scientific method. And that seemed to me to be really incongruent with human experience, because humans have experiences, they have mystical experiences. I've interviewed young adults who've never set foot in a church who feel that they've experienced God somehow. There's a rise in Buddhist meditation and mindfulness and depth psychology. People are talking in the language of the soul. That's really just not in psychology and sociology anymore. And so I started to wonder, where did the, like, why is there no soul in the social sciences? And reading the history of modern philosophy really opened up a lot of my eyes to see that a lot of the modern social sciences that I've studied, for all the good that they do, try to claim that everything we need to know about the human person can be subjected to the scientific method. And all of this stuff about tradition and creeds, all of that is sort of a quaint artifact. Maybe we should just get rid of it. And then Giussani, I found to be actually trying to rediscover or provide a language to think about the human person as open to mystery, and as experiencing God in some direct way, while also upholding that there is an authority to the tradition, right? And I think in The Risk of Education, which is a short book, I really recommend anybody who's interested in either education or just a better understanding of the human person read Risk of Education. What Giussani's doing there is trying to lay out a method of education that's very attuned to human experience. And he makes this rather provocative claim that even the creeds of Christianity should be subject to human experience and verification in some way. But that doesn't mean that there's no ultimate truth, right? Human experience in and of itself has to be measured up against some kind of objective truth. Is that a correct characterization of Giussani?
Yeah, I mean, I think I was particularly moved by him when the manner by which words are defined. I mean, reading Giussani is somewhat complicated because words you previously thought you knew are not actually what they mean, right? So the word reason for Giussani means to face the real, right? To be rational is to face reality as it is, and reality comes at us in different ways. And, you know, it's appropriate to employ a scientific methodology when you're trying to determine the interrelationship between an acid and a base. The thing itself has told you how to use it. But it's different, for example, than if you try to do that and then move to poetry or to move to love, right? It would be odd if I, as a husband, went home to my wife and tried to measure or assess or turn our relationship into a project, right? There's something else. It would be irrational to do so. So the reason is to face, I have to face this properly according to reason. And so too then, can we understand religion then within that mode, that there's a rational way of facing up to religion. And there is the task of appropriation, the task of taking something on for ourselves. You know, as I remind the students I teach when I do this, you know, if you walk into a class and you're charged with teaching the incarnation, you can't, when you propose that, the student has to think along with you with that. They have to understand along with, they have to actually give themselves to that. And that's true, you know, in religion or otherwise. Anyone who's taught literature knows that when you propose, like, this book is extraordinary, it will transform your life, the risk is that that task in which the student actually has to perform along with you, think through with you. But that doesn't mean that then you employ the scientific method upon that and say, okay, well, that's how the best way to teach this book. And so what I found for Giussani was a freedom to actually propose, and to propose a way of rationality that didn't eliminate mystery.
Mm-hmm. I've been teaching the risk of education in the seminar that I teach on liberal arts education. And the very first thing you said resonated with one of my students. I wrote about this in an article on how Giussani uses tradition and authority in education. One of my students, after she read Risk of Education, she said, Luigi Giussani uses common words in uncommon ways. That's really strange, but also very compelling. And I think what she was saying was precisely like you said, Giussani, in a lot of his writings, he's doing very deep philosophical and theological work. And I think what's often not understood about Giussani is what a brilliant philosopher and theologian he was. Mm-hmm. Because he was a Catholic priest and he was teaching theology at the university, first at the seminary in Italy, and then he switched to a high school and he ended up founding the movement of communion and liberation. And he spent most of his life as the head of this movement. But he easily could have written books on theology and philosophy, but instead, most of his writings have come to us, at least those in English, have been translations of pastoral talks that he gave. So in those talks, he's not saying, now I'm critiquing the Hegelian view of history, and here I'm drawing on Augustine, and here I'm using von Balthasar. He doesn't exactly do that, but for me, I could see what he was doing. So in the way Giussani's using reason, is exactly critiquing the whole modern turn, which has made reason synonymous with the scientific method, and anything about faith, by definition, unreasonable or an illusion.
That's right. Yeah.
So that's one key word, reason, for him. And so reason for Giussani, can you tell us again, for, as you said, reason for Giussani is anything that helps us understand reality, correct?
Yeah. It's the proper way of facing what's real. It's reasonable to, it's reasonable for me to go home and presume that my spouse loves me based upon the years that we've spent together, the years that we have, what we've endured, especially over the last 8 weeks with two children at home. It's reasonable to presume this, and love has this own kind of reason. It's not irrational. Like, I'm not tossed in some sort of, like, a Kierkegaardian throwing myself without reason into every relationship, you know, this jump into this dark abyss. It's a reason, but it's a reason that is appropriate to the thing that is being looked at, the thing that I'm trying to understand that bestows itself to me. The thing that I look at gives me the method I should use. Method isn't something I implant upon reality and employ universally. That erases all of the world, that tries to over-rationalize, in a bad sense, the world. The world itself gives me the method to understand it if I'm attentive to that. And that that is very attractive when you think about the different ways of teaching in a classroom, whether you're teaching religion or you're teaching philosophy or you're teaching science. The thing is telling you the way to engage with it if you're attentive to the thing.
Okay, so I do want to move us to Q&A in about 5 minutes. So if you have questions, go ahead, start putting them in the Q&A box. But there's a few more things that we've got to hit here before we move on from this discussion about Giussani and how he uses certain terms. One thing that you said, and I just want to highlight this, for Giussani, reason is anything that helps us to understand reality. And for Giussani, it's extremely important that there are things in reality that are a given. There's an objective truth to reality that's outside of our thinking about reality or about doing something in reality. Now, that may sound obvious, but that's not exactly the case for Dewey. For Dewey, it's not clear to me that there's an objective truth outside of the mind or outside of experience, because nothing is given for Dewey. So I think for Giussani, that's one thing. So then that brings me kind of to the key question. Look, you've been in these kinds of conversations, as have I. Philosophers have spent thousands of years and thousands of pages trying to understand what does it mean to experience something. But Giussani has a particular idea about what it means to experience something, and it comes from his understanding of the human person. There's actually a wonderful article on how Giussani uses the word experience. It's in Communio magazine, written by Father Anthony Lopez. And here, I wanted to just bridge this question because it's the center question that I wanted to get at today. What does Giussani mean when he says human experience? What does he mean by this word experience, and how is it different from what Dewey means?
So he doesn't mean what we simply undergo. He doesn't mean that experience is what we do, right? So that has been the popular contrast that's been made, that there's something like a tradition, right, which is mere content, and then experience is what we undergo. Rather, the human being is perpetually experiencing. Giussani, of course, while offering his own sort of unique read on it, is drawing from an extensive tradition within sort of philosophical and theological understanding in the church, that within sort of Christianity, that experience is the fullness of the human sensation, the human life in all of the way that it's lived. It's the intellect and the thinking and the wondering and the imagining and the reasoning and that whole sort of sense of experiencing that is what it means to be human. And even in some ways, the tradition itself is already for Giussani an experience, right? Mm-hmm. It's the experience that's been handed on to you across time and space and across the tradition. It is also the experience of a primordial experience, right? That initial encounter with the person of Jesus. So experience has this richness that I think the Latin word for it, like sensio, the sensation, but not just pure sensation, but of wonderment, of understanding, of like fullness. It's just this deeper sense of experience than simply that which is undergone. Right, experience is not that which is simply undergone. It is the fullness of what it means to be human altogether. When I look outside and, you know, if I look outside and gaze at a tree and the thoughts that come along with that and the what I know and what I've received before and also the very aliveness of myself, all of this is part of the experience of being human.
This is great. We're getting some fantastic questions in the Q&A, so I want to move to that in a minute. But I will just highlight again, the article I mentioned from Communio by Father Antonio Lopez makes this point, as you just said. For Giussani, to experience isn't only doing something in the world. Experience isn't only perceiving something. There's this kind of sense in Giussani of an original experience, which is an openness to the mystery and the transcendence. But that kind of original experience is also, as you said, the human ability for wonder and awe and sort of staring at the goodness of creation with a kind of contemplative gaze. We don't have to, whereas for Dewey, everything becomes an instrument. Knowledge is always an instrument, right? Knowledge is always supposed to, and that's actually what some people like about it, that in Dewey, like, there's a problem to be solved and you fix it and you go on to the next problem and you go to the next one, you go to the next one, you go to the next one. Problem is, in Dewey's framework, there's never a place for pure awe or pure contemplation. Because all of knowledge is instrumental. It's supposed to do something. And what Giussani is pulling us back to is, hey, look, all that's good. That's fine and dandy. But that's not the fullness of the human experience. Love, joy, they're not instruments. It's And experiences of love and joy tell us something fundamentally true about who we are as human beings. And people have questions about the origins of things that can't be answered with a kind of instrumental scientific form of knowledge, right?
Yeah, and it's that knowledge, I mean, for Giussani, rather, truth, he takes this sort of Thomistic approach to truth and then sort of defines it anew, right? It's the adequation of the intellect, our ability to understand, to wonder, to imagine, to reason. That's what intellect is, but it's all that, our desire to understand with reality, and that's truth. It's a correspondence, but not a correspondence like I have a thing and then I share it with you across the thing directly, but it's more like a attunement, a correspondence like that's it, that's the thing. And it's not like a kind of weird intuition, but it's precisely, I mean, in some ways, this is how other theories of knowledge focus. I mean, when it's even how science focus happens, right? What does the scientist do when they come to understand the interrelationship between two things that they couldn't understand before? What is that act that takes place? It's insight. It's an explosion of insight, which is not just, like this is a method and I know that the equation works. It comes with this energy, with this excitement to see like, this is it. Like this is the thing. And it's that kind of truth, like that is what it means to recognize the truth. And that truth exists, right? The task for all, but Giussani, unlike a certain kind of traditionalism, wouldn't say like, well, that's easy to do, right? Like we just gotta pass on these ideas to people and they'll get this truth. The task of truth is the risk of discovery, right? Is it true? And the gift of, you know, in Christianity, at least when I tell my students, like the risk you take with your students is that you have to give them the space to discover this truth, because you must trust that what's given actually allows that, right? So that's the truth. And that's what makes it fun, is it really is the interplay between that which is proposed and the person, of course, always lived within community.
Excellent, thank you. We are going to move to the Q&A. We have a number of questions there. Please send in more and we'll try to get to them. I'm gonna just answer quickly one of the questions in the Q&A because I think a lot of listeners will wanna know this. Fiona Holly is asking if we have any reading recommendations to present on the limitations of Dewey and his influence on modern education. My top suggestion for that would be a book by Hank Edmondson. And the title of it, oh my gosh, I have it somewhere near me, but it's Hank Edmondson. Maybe Michael Paul, who's working with me at Scala, can put it in the Q&A because I forgot the exact name. But I met Hank at a Liberty Fund and he organized this weekend colloquium on education, which is where I first read Dewey and Maritain. There we go, Hank Edmondson, John Dewey and the Decline of American Education, published by ISI Books. What I like about Hank's book is that he talks really specifically about Dewey's concept of human nature, about Dewey's rejection of tradition and his rejection of metaphysics. And he talks about kind of how these problems in Dewey persist in American education today, with its emphasis on novelty and innovation. And there's no real canon of text. What matters for Dewey is more that we get novel ideas, not that we study anything from the past. In Dewey, it's not really clear to me that we need to know history. History isn't always relevant to the future, so why do we need to know that? You know, it's not clear to me that Dewey can help us understand why we need to know handwriting if everything is digital, you know, those kinds of things. Before we move to other questions, do you have any other texts you want to recommend for people who want to understand critiques of Dewey?
No, that's a good one. I mean, most of my other critiques are from articles, but I think that's a great one you've chosen.
Okay, great. Well, now let's look at, let's take a question from Colleen Swain. She wants to know, Dewey's vision of religiosity and education sounds a bit like the mindfulness movement so embraced in schools, including many religious institutions. Focus on your behaviors and values without the creedal stuff. So she wants to know what's our reaction when we hear mindfulness used in the context of Catholic education? I'll let you answer that one first, Tim.
Sure. Yeah, it's an interesting question because I've often found in educational literature a real interest in Eastern approaches to mindfulness because they're perceived to be doctrinally devoid of doctrine, right? Like the goal is to empty yourself of any particular beliefs, and it's just sort of focus or mindfulness. And in some ways, I mean, I think the desire for mindfulness is the desire to break out of a world in which the classroom is sheer activity. I mean, think about the last 8 weeks of your life. And if your life is anything like my life, there was a lot of terrible things that happened with the closure of the world. But on the other hand, there's also been an occasion to really attend to that which is there. My critique of mindfulness, right, is that it's so in Catholic schools in particular, is there actually is a richer tradition of contemplative being, of contemplative life that we could draw from that is as integral to this as any sort of mindfulness conversation. So to me, right, this is where I return to a book I mentioned at the beginning. When I think about the love of learning and the desire for God, right, knowing is a matter of contemplation. It is a matter of attending. It is a matter of a kind of doxology or rejoicing, a praise. But why couldn't a Catholic school draw on that tradition rather than sort of mindfulness? Not because mindfulness is wrong and perhaps it has an effect and a positive dimension within public education, but couldn't a Catholic school be particular in its proposal rather than reductive? And I think part of it is the assumption, and this is why Catholic schools do this, is because they actually don't know the tradition well enough to know its particularities. And the temptation is to reduce the tradition to these universals, right? So what John of the Cross says about contemplation and what this sort of mindfulness practice done in contemporary pedagogy, they're really the same thing, but they're not, right? And so you have a desire to rationalize the practice instead of actually attending to its particularity. So I would prefer that Catholic schools actually retrieve these traditions by the way, so that we could gain, sort of engage in authentic dialogue with those who are different than us, to say things like, well, that is different, but I'm grateful that actually there is a commonness there, but the difference also matters. And so that's my thought on that. I don't know if you, Margarita, if you have thoughts.
I'll just briefly add that I would recommend a book by Dr. Gregory Botaro. It's called The Mindful Catholic. He has a wonderful appendix where he describes the difference between Eastern mindfulness meditation and a Catholic view of contemplation. He argues that Catholics can sometimes use the term mindfulness but need to distinguish it from Christian contemplation and prayer. He wants to retain the term because he's trying to help Catholics, for example, working in the psychology profession or perhaps in social work, to understand what mindfulness-based anxiety reduction techniques are. So he wants to make mindfulness a technique, not a philosophy of the person. And I think, you know, so that's one way of thinking about it. But everything else you said, Tim, I completely agree with. Yeah. And there's a rich, you know, literature and contemplation that the Catholic traditions can and should draw on. But I think being able to point where that's similar to the mindfulness movement will help validate the feeling amongst a lot of students that they've been turned into a machine and that their minds are treated like supercomputers. And so mindfulness is responding to a real desire from students to recover contemplation, and being able to speak to them in the terms that they may have encountered, I think is an important thing for Catholic educators to be able to do. Okay, now I'd like to take a question from Daryl DiMarzio. He wants to know if we can explore a bit more Dewey's philosophical anthropology and the similarities and differences with Giussani. So, for example, Dewey claims that there's really no end goal to education for Dewey beyond growth, and the aim of growth is to be able to grow more. It's kind of tautological. And what are the consequences, he wants to know, for students who tend to think of growth and learning as its own end rather than a growing towards God?
Yeah. Well, yeah, this is a great question. Daryl is, I read his work when I was at Boston College also, and it helped me think through a number of these things. So I'm very grateful that Daryl's here. He's a professor at the University of Scranton, and his writings have been very important to me. So I'm grateful that he asked that question. The one thing I would say, I think growth for its own sake, right? To have no telos to an education means that the person is just developing, right? There's actually a kind of evolutionary, there's an undercurrent of evolutionary theory to Dewey that the human person is this ever evolving entity that is incomplete, and its incompleteness is to be evolving towards greater and greater levels of perfection, right? If we can get this right, and the perfection is not, has no end to it beyond development. This, of course, I think is very different than a Christian sense that the human person is made for beatitude, for happiness in its fullest sense, for what Thomas would say is sort of the beatific vision, to see God face to face. And so the end of that education changes, because then some of what's proposed isn't just then about growth. One, it's about actually some of what's proposed or given within the Christian tradition has a wisdom unto itself. There's a reason that we read these texts or these ideas or encounter these doctrines, not because we're just growing generally, but we're growing towards an end, which is union with God. And that also means that the horizon of it, it doesn't change the horizon, right? Like the goal then isn't suddenly in this education to say like, okay, well, since I'm growing, my telos is towards God, then I only need to know these eight things and then I'm done, right? It actually makes it even larger. I think about Augustine as an alternative model, right? Where are you at the end of Augustine's Confessions? At where you were at the beginning, right? Which is asking a question about who is this God, and that act of questing, that desiring, that searching is part of the knowing. And you can't know it in the way that you know other things, and what you're left with is praise. So I think it changes everything, because then if the human person is a liturgical creature, a creature made for worship, made ultimately to give themselves away in love to God who is love, then that changes the content, it changes what's proposed, it changes how you think about it, and it changes even what a successful education looks like. And I think that's where this sort of theme could be really important, which is it destroys our limited conception of what constitutes success.
Great, that was fantastic. I'll just add to this question that in my work with students, you know, when I was in faculty at Yale and living in an undergraduate dorm and reading books with students on happiness, I discovered that a lot of students want to talk about something other than growth for growth's sake, because that's all they've been told, is that what makes them valuable is that they can grow more and achieve more, and they sense there's something not quite right there, that they have limitations, that they have failings, that they might experience mental illness, that they might be abusing drugs and they need to kind of change their behavior. So in my experience, young people are looking for a psychology or an anthropology that's deeper than you can perfect yourself, because that actually ends up setting them up for this kind of goal that they feel like they can't do. And I think the other consequence that it has is that it makes everything a competition. I had one student who told me she won an award at Princeton University for service. And she's like, I'm not allowed to say that I serve people because I love God. Like, service is a competition, right? Everything is a competition. Who can serve more? Who can do more things? So I would also recommend you teach it and I teach it. I published, I believe, in Church Life Journal on this book, Jean Leclerc's The Love of Learning and the Lay Desire for God, and the Desire for God. I published on that, and I would recommend that as a helpful way to think about learning as having an intrinsic dimension. The life of the mind is supposed to be intrinsically joyful. It's not only about growth, which, by the way, philosophers like Dewey can't really tell you what growth is. It's supposed to be somehow obvious, but it's not always obvious. All right, we have a lot more questions. Brett Bertuccio wants to know, he was struck by Tim's analysis of Dewey's operative theology. And he wants to ask, to what degree was this view originally Dewey's? And to what degree was it percolating in other places in the 19th century? And where do we see this operative theology in contemporary America?
Yeah, so Dewey's conception, it was actually fairly normative, the kind of reduction of religion to this common faith, to almost a kind of democratic experiment. The place that I see it most operative, even just sort of passed on quite directly, would be in institutions of higher education that saw their entire mission as religious, whether they put forward any explicitly religious proposition at all, right? So all colleges and universities commence as religious entities that are invited to sort of, that their students are invited to to attend sort of intentional religious instruction. Eventually this disappears. This is the story that George Morrison tells in his sort of the decline or the decline of religion in the American sort of Protestant college university. And then eventually college presidents, everyone determines and they come to terms with the fact that simply teaching people to think or to understand or to participate in the democratic world is itself a kind of religious entity. It's the kingdom of God come at hand. If you read Dewey's pedagogic creed, he uses the kingdom of God precisely in this way. What is the kingdom of God? It's the place of justice and of truth and where things are sought. It's not necessarily where the Son of Man comes on a cloud of glory to judge the nations, right? This is the kingdom of God. And so yeah, it was in the world, and I think it's still in the world, and it's the temptation that's endemic in Catholicism. In any religious group that claims particularity is to reduce that particularity to truth claims that could be agreed simply by everyone, right? Automatically. And that actually I suspect it's coming to an end, because in some ways those who still care about religion care about specific truth claims, and they also know that they can dwell peaceably in a society with people who don't think the same claims that they do, and that actually is a better model than pretending, for example, that I and the evangelical Christian, you know, I'm a Catholic, the evangelical Christian, share everything in common. We don't. And we would have fundamental disagreements. And so the goal isn't to reduce those. It's actually to deal with the particularities of it. And so, yeah, I think it's endemic, and Dewey is simply taking up what's found, and it is universally contemporary, or it remains, I think, American civil religion par excellence, no matter sort of where you turn. It allows us to get along, but it also then turns religion into that which is not. And thus we're surprised, for example, that people believe religion enough that they do live their lives in a way that makes other people uncomfortable. That actually these things are more than like, well, be a decent human being and make sure you work for the kingdom.
Briefly, I would just say that anyone who's not that familiar with Dewey, his pedagogical creed, which you mentioned, is very short and very readable. And after this dialogue, I think you might understand some of the nuances in what Dewey is saying. But I would very much agree with Tim that Dewey's ideas are not entirely original to him. In some ways, they are the kind of American creed of civil religion, that religion is a set of values that inspires us to live democratically and have faith in progress and helps us all get along. And any aspect of religion that requires supernatural belief or might actually be claiming something is true that's different than a different religion, that's bad and that's intolerant, and we have to get rid of that. So I think understanding this kind of this twist on the meaning of religion away from particularities and away from truth claims is extremely important to understand a lot of the ways that religion is used in contemporary U.S. Okay.
Eric, by the way, is doing his doctoral research on American religion and education. So you should have him on here, the person who asked that question.
Oh, great. Well, also, he may know this, but let me mention it to the audience and have Michael Paul put it in the chat box. I would also send people to read Patrick Neen's book on, is it American Faith? Is what's it called? Democratic Faith, where he answers this question of, I think, the longer term political implications of this changing meaning of religion, where the religion ends up becoming the political system itself, not God, right? And there's some issues there that I think Deneen is really hitting on in that book. Okay, now to a question that comes up a lot from educators. And I wanna thank Casey Bales for asking this question. How can educators deal with these questions about transcendence when schools are really obsessed with outcomes. And she puts this poem in by Michael Rosen that says, you know, first they needed data about the children to find out what they're learning. Then they needed data about the children to make sure they are learning. Then the children only learned what can be put into data, and then children became data. So just for educators that I know you work with and I've talked to who are working in this outcomes obsessed world, how do they bring these questions of transcendence back into education?
Yeah, I mean, it's a hard question. I don't even have all the answers. Margarita, you've been doing a couple of these conversations already. What would you say to start off?
Well, I would say that, you know, on a practical level, I would draw on perhaps my colleague, Roosevelt Montas, who was on an earlier level of learning, and on the teachers I've talked to and the teachers he works with. He's a professor at Columbia. Teachers who are going to apply this model of education that we're talking about, many of them are going to be swimming against the stream in their home institutions. And you may have to comply with a certain kind of expectation, but I firmly believe that an educator who reads The Risk of Education or Maritain at the Crossroads and who goes into the classroom ready to connect on a deep level in the soul of those students is swimming against the stream and is doing something fundamentally different than other teachers will be doing. I did say in a previous panel that I was on with Roosevelt that to change the structures of evaluation and credentialing and assessment is a different battle than influencing the culture of the classroom. And I think a teacher can read these books and put it into practice by the way that they teach, by the way that they interact with the students, by the way that they love their students. That's not necessarily going to change the way you get promoted or the way you get hired. But don't think for a moment that a teacher who's studying these works and practicing in the classroom is not having an impact on the students, because I can tell you that they are. And I was inspired by Roosevelt, who said that, look, anyone who aspires to this ideal of education we're talking about is going to be swimming against the stream. And that's how I define my role as a teacher, is to swim against the stream.
Yeah, that's really helpful. Yeah, I think about, I teach this course now at Notre Dame on the development of the sacrament of marriage that talks about like love, and it actually ends up at the end being a little bit more surprisingly practical. And I always feel guilty about that. I have to sort of deny that part of the classroom, because I think to myself, I don't know, I should be teaching them how to read, you know, Bernard of Clairvaux on love. And that really is the measure of what's success, right? Like that would be what's real. And yet at the same time, you know, the questions my students are bringing to the encounters with the text are things like, well, what is love? And why can't I find it? And what is, and why do I struggle so much with it? And in some sense, you know, I think back to my reading of Giussani, and I think it led to a conversion in me, which was the opposite of a kind of experiential education I wanted to reject wasn't then like breaking my students down with the utter difficulty and misery of content. It was fostering an encounter. And there are still things to measure, like I need to know that they actually read the book, but I had to give up personally as an educator the embarrassment that comes when that people take your class because it helps their lives. Like that's so bad, right? I can't believe I just said that. Like that people, like in higher ed, that you feel bad because people take your class because they get something meaningful out of it, rather than that it's hard and prepares them for graduate school. I had to get over that.
Hmm. One last piece of advice and then we'll move on. In addition to all the outcomes assessments that my students have to do, believe me, this happens in college, it happens in grad school too. I have students write a qualitative evaluation of my class. Tell me one thing that you learned, one thing you're gonna take away, and how would you describe this class to somebody else? And I save those and I put them in my teaching portfolio, because other than numbers, what administrators are moved by is students' experience. And if students praise your class and praise your teaching and talk about how it transformed them, administrators are going to listen to the voice of students. So collect this qualitative kind of assessment alongside the measurements. Okay, now we have a question from Matthew Muller. He wants to know, Tim, I heard you describe the risk that a student must take regarding giving themselves to a proposal or to a text. Is there a risk on the part of the educator, and what does that involve? Thanks.
Yeah, there's always the risk, right? There's the risk that I have to take in teaching anything, right? The risk that I have to engage in the same sort of encounter and measure myself against the encounter. There's the risk of the encounter with the student, right? To take seriously their question. And this method is riskier, right? The classroom in some sense becomes a space of risk because it does become a place of encounter and things sometimes get interrupted. I'll always remember, I forget what it was. There was a day in which my students got really obsessed with the question of suffering and evil. I had this extraordinary plan set up to do this amazing thing, but they just became obsessed and I had to break the whole thing down. Like it fell apart, it was inefficient. It didn't look like my syllabus fell apart for a day, not just for a day, but like for at least 3 days. And it wasn't because I was malprepared, but because the students, their inquiry jumped in and their wonder and their experience in the richest sense of that term jumped in and it took over, and it took over the class in some sense. And I went along with that. And so, yeah, there is a risk in this. It's the risk of real encounter, of really, of the encounter with your concrete students, your encounter with a concrete tradition that you propose and that was proposed to you, and that in that proposal, you recognize that you learned something anew and that you have to judge yourself anew by it, and that your students also do that for you. My students regularly challenge me, and I don't mean like they teach me in some like nice way, like, oh, my students teach me more than, of course, but I mean that like concretely they challenge me. They force me to, they're offering the proposition back to me to reflect upon. There is a risk to that. It's a lot harder than just teaching a list of things on a list, or rather, I find.
Great. I would also just add that I think the risk to the student is that this process of this method of education that Giussani proposes requires that the student be willing to, as you said, to make judgments, but also to make a commitment to a particular way of life. The end of this journey for Giussani is not eternal doubt, which it actually is, I think, for Dewey. It's certainty, and certainty requires commitment, and it requires kind of, you know, an existential commitment. Now on to a question from my friend, Brandon Vidyanathan at Catholic University of America. He wants to know, it seems that the concepts of judgment and meaningfulness are crucial aspects of experience for Giussani. It seems that you cannot even have an experience without making a judgment about the meaning of things for Giussani here. But for Dewey, Dewey thinks that truth entails bracketing meaningfulness because it's subjective. Only the scientific method is objective. Whereas for Giussani, meaningfulness is objective. Is that correct, he asks?
So I don't think anything would be considered subjective to Dewey, because he doesn't think there's sort of just a pure subject. It's true insofar as it allows you to advance and to progress and to move and to solve the problem, right? And so that becomes the mode of truth. It's true because it works or it doesn't work. And so it's not sort of merely a matter sort of subjectiveness, right? So Dewey could see like, well, the scripture, Dewey may even acknowledge, and in fact did acknowledge early in his career, that the scriptures were true. But the truth of them is that they allowed a community to gather around a central idea and move forward towards this kingdom. But the particular truth claims may not be valid. And so I would say that certainly for Dewey, and I'll let Margarita speak for more for Giussani at this stage, I would say that what's true is that which allows you to move forward, right? The true thing is what allows the experiment to continue. And it's added then to the body of knowledge, and then you can move forward to advance knowledge from there. And that's what makes it true. But if it doesn't allow you to move forward, then truth really doesn't enter into the equation.
Yeah, I would agree with you. I mean, I think this is where Dewey actually probably uses words like subjective or subjectivity, but what he means by it philosophically is unclear, because everything that's subjective has to be done in action, and that starts to be kind of confusing. So I would just say that I would agree that I think that Dewey only really sees truth in the scientific method, and everything else, he might talk about subjectivity or he might talk about meaning. But he's not using it in any kind of objective sense, which I think is not the case at all for Giussani. He thinks that there is an objective quality to who we are as human persons and to the meanings that we create in the world. Okay, so now let's talk about, here we have a question from PJ Butler. He wants to know, or she wants to know, it seems to me that the method of Giussani is particularly applicable to people at the adolescent stage and older, when students are coming alive to the elementary needs of the heart, against which they are helped to compare the proposal of tradition. How might Giussani's method be helpful for pre-adolescent students when those questions aren't usually felt yet?
Yeah, it's a good question. You know, I think about this a lot because I have pre-adolescent children that I spend a lot of time with right now, two of them who are 7 and 3. And I think if you read The Risk of Education, Giussani emphasizes that education doesn't begin just with the school, right? The first proposal that's bestowed is the family. Like the family offers a proposal from the beginning. This is a form of life. This is what it means to exist, to wonder. And you're right, you know, my 7-year-old doesn't say like, why do we pray every night before dinner? What is the purpose of that? What if I don't want to do it, right? Like that's not where he is right now. And yet it is a proposal and it is being offered as a kind of educational, as a sort of proposal to him. And so in that sense, I think it's important to recognize the role of a family as passing on a tradition, as a society, that children are being proposed this. They may not yet be, as he notes in The Risk of Education, taking all these things out of their backpack and examining them and saying, what am I gonna take and what am I gonna leave? But that we are doing this. And so as a father, it often means that it makes me think, like, what am I proposing to my child, right? What's my relationship with my smartphone? And how much do I look at it? What proposition am I making about the meaning of life to my child on this? How distracted am I? How do I deal with punishment? How do I deal with my own, if you've ever had a child in a tantrum, the first thing you want to do is to scream, because that's the reaction. They scream, you scream. How do you not scream, right? So everything I do is inviting this child into a moment of what is the meaning of life? What hypothesis am I going to bestow to you? Where does my authority come from? Right now, my authority comes from my kids because I am dad. But one day they're just going to be like, well, I don't care. You're dad. And the authority that comes becomes of my personhood. Do I live this out? Am I a person who lives this out fully? And so the family is an integral dimension in the education of young children. And I think the school then has to be understood in relationship to that first dimension, which is that the family is proposing a way of life. And so is the school. And that's sometimes where conflicts enter in. So I think it helps us think about elementary or younger education too. I think about what I want my son to not have in school is I want to avoid giving him the idea that his value or merit will be dependent on his success in this. And if the school proposes that, I will fight the school on that, right? And so I have a particular role as a parent to fight against the credentialing, the logic of success of a kind of method of learning that I wouldn't even say is grounded in Dewey, but grounded more in our infinite desire for to make our children into workers from the very beginning of their lives. Like, I'm gonna fight against that. And so I think all of this helps me think as a dad about what it's like to have kids.
Yeah. Well, that's the next question I wanna get to. I'll only add to what you say that there's going to be a new edition of Newman's essays on the Benedictine way of life and the Benedictine schools. And Giussani was very influenced by the Benedictines. And when it comes to elementary education, I have seen schools at the elementary level adopting aspects of the Benedictine, what I call poetic way of living. I've written the introduction to this new book with Clooney Press. If you've not followed Clooney Press, they're doing a great job bringing out some of these classic texts. And so I do think elementary schools, I agree with what you said about the family, but elementary schools that I have visited, like one called St. Benedict's outside of Boston, and one I also visited in Vienna, Austria, have been inspired by Benedict to have kind of you know, hands-on science experiments, play, and kind of inculcating. Children have this amazing sense of creativity and mystery. But children also are not against memorizing things. Children like to memorize poems, they like to memorize songs. So there are ways that this can be applied. Now, this leads me to a question from Sophia Carosa, and she wants to know, in a time when many of us are learning from home, apparently without experiencing things as we would on campus, how can Giussani's concept of experience set us free and enable education to continue?
Whew. What do you think? So I like almost want Sophia to answer it. I mean, know her. She was valedictorian at Notre Dame 2 years ago. I bet she'd better be able to answer this than me and is a sort of active practitioner. But I'll throw it back to you, Margarita. What do you think?
Well, I mean, I think in learning from home, we're not experiencing the kind of social world and the relationships that we normally are. But for me, experience as Luigi Giussani uses it, and as if you've said, experience is also this kind of sense of original experience, wonder and awe and creativity. So in addition to my tasks that I have to keep up with, I've been reading Dante's Inferno, I've been reading Augustine's Confessions, and right now I lack the community to discuss those, though I actually have an online group to discuss Dante. But there's a way that when you're reading some of these classical texts, you're experiencing in this original sense that Giussani is talking about. You're asking yourself these big fundamental questions of human life. And I also have written about this, like in a time of crisis, it pushes us to ask these fundamental questions about who we are and what we desire. And asking those questions and reading some classical sources on it is an incredible education that we're having.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, I was thinking a little bit about Sophia. I was thinking a little bit about Giussani's, right, the task of this conversation and these questions, right, is to recognize how all things are signs, right? And there's a way for us to treat COVID-19 not as sign, but as something simply to get over and to skip over, right? Say like, okay, now we're in this time where we're away from campus and we can't see one another and we're not living the life we imagined we were going to live perhaps. And okay, how do I get out of this? Or we could treat it as sign. And I find that I have been, like I've been attentive to it and I feel the question interrupted. And my wife and I, we've been talking about this, is like the secret part of this is that in some ways I miss my students more than anything. I miss my coworkers. I miss seeing other human beings face to face at all that are not related to me at this stage. But on the other hand, it's raising questions about the kind of life that I was living, right? Like, I was traveling all the time. I was moving all the time. I never had space for just being. I didn't organize my life in the process. So I feel myself being asked these very questions in such that I'm returning in some sense to these original experiences that COVID's asking of me. What is community life to me? What is my commitment to my neighborhood? Right? That, by the way, is all that I have right now, this little neighborhood. So anyway, I've been really appreciative of Giussani teaching me not to say like, okay, what comes after COVID? How can I get beyond this? But actually using this as the sign that becomes educative for me.
Great, thank you. Another philosophical question, and then I'll try to wind us down with a couple of questions. But one question's coming in is about the relationship between Dewey and Giussani with 20th century phenomenological thinkers, and how different is Giussani's view of experience from those proposed in the phenomenological tradition? I have some thoughts on that, but do you have some thoughts on that?
Please go okay. For that one, yeah.
Well, I would just say I recently taught a weekend seminar on personalist philosophy as part of Scala and the Abigail Adams Institute, and we read the phenomenological tradition and we read the personalists. So we read, you know, a little bit of Sartre, we read Mounier, then we read some Maritain, some Edith Stein, some John Paul II. And I would say that Giussani certainly is attentive to the phenomenology tradition, but within phenomenology, there are really deep debates between idealists and realists or Thomists and what I came away from that seminar was that phenomenology and an attention to experience without some kind of philosophical system to order that experience and to connect love and joy in some kind of system is lacking. So the phenomenologists that I find the most compelling are people who were also really influenced by Thomism. People like Maritain, people like Wojtyla, and others, frankly, like Emmanuel Mounier. Sometimes you can't tell the difference between him and Sartre because he just uses terms without slowing down to define them or talking about a sense of order of our loves. And so I would say that Giussani is probably very influenced by phenomenology, but he's absolutely still in many ways in line with a kind of Thomism that has a sense of ordering to our loves. That's how I would answer that question. Okay, let's take a couple more. So we have a question, if you want to get back to this one, about Hegel. And I will say that, you know, the recording is always posted on Scala's YouTube channel. And here we have a question from Katie Groves about, what does Giussani say about Hegelianism? What's Giussani's critique of Hegelianism? I'll leave that one to you, Tim.
Yeah, so I don't know if the critique is direct in Giussani on sort of the question of Hegelianism. Again, I think Margarita notes that he wasn't writing directly sort of in favor of that. I mean, he was inspired by Hans Urs von Balthasar, who had sort of very direct critiques against Hegelism. But if you think about the desire to reduce any religious tradition to something that is simply a kind of a philosophical proposal, right? A rational thing, then the whole system of Giussani is a critique against Hegelism, right? It's a critique against the desire for an understanding religion as a series of universal principles that pass on through history again and again and again, and that develops in this ever-ending arc of progress. And that is a critique that is a very loose Hegelianism. It's not Hegel in general. There's a lot of reading that would have to go into Hegel to get it, but it's the stunning particularity of the proposal that has to be given as it's lived out in a community that isn't just like a communion of friendship, of love, of sharing concrete forms of life together that is never reduced to an idea. And it's incarnational at its very roots. And so I think the whole thing is a critique, even if there are others who know Giussani's writings better than I do, that would respond to that. But I couldn't point to like an exact moment where he offers a critique.
Great, thank you. I would agree that Giussani's whole system is a critique of Hegelianism. All right, so final questions, because we are running out of time here. We have a question from Henry Burt, who wants to know, he's, by the way, an alum of Scala Summer Program and an incoming PhD student at Princeton Theological Seminary. He wants to know, the sphere of religion and science often seem to have different values they pursue. What would Dewey say about the role of experience in one sphere as having the potential to modify how we approach the other? So can experience serve as a moderating force in the dialectic between religion and science, rather than serving to confirm the values in one sphere and negating the values in another?
Yeah, so I'd have to think more about that. Part of it is, I would need to know, like, well, what do you mean by religion? And what's the supposed dialectic between religion and science? I often suppose that the values of religion and science are conceived to be so radically distinct based more on myth than reality, right? So what does science do? It is a certain way of knowing the world, but it need not, I suppose, radically have values that are distinct than some of like what Giussani speaks about elementary sort of experience. I mean, why does anyone become interested in chemistry at all? But is there not sort of an initial wonder, or if the human body based a sort of wonder and what's brought to terms? And so I think there's a long tradition there's a developing tradition. I have colleagues who work on this. I'm happy to connect one-on-one to get the question more. If you'd like to, you can send me an email. And I can connect you with these colleagues that work trying to understand that religion and science are not so radically distinct, and in fact, there's great myths of this grand clash between the two, and that there are dispositions of wonder and love that are at the heart of the scientific enterprise that are closer to kind of religious dispositions than anything else. And so that's not an answer to your question, partially because I didn't fully understand your question, which undoubtedly I'd like to. If you pass it along to me, I can try a bit harder.
Well, thank you for those of you who've been posting interesting articles in the chat box. I saw someone posted an article there for Henry to look at, and we can continue this conversation. I will venture a quick answer to the two questions in the queue. One is from Brian Pedraza, who wants to know apart what are the differing conceptions of the role of tradition in Giussani and Dewey. And I would point you to the article I wrote on tradition and authority in Giussani. Dewey really doesn't have a place for tradition. He's very critical of it. And Giussani is trying to bring tradition back, but alongside the need to verify that tradition through experience. So I think Dewey sets up a false opposition between experience and tradition, and Giussani's trying to put them back together. That's, I think, extremely important. And I actually find, and I say this in my article, students find that really, really exciting. Students are not against any kind of tradition. I think they're against a tradition that doesn't allow them to verify it. And oftentimes, in my experience, people who say they don't have a tradition or don't have a starting point sneak one in from the back and don't want to put it out on the table and discuss it. So at least Giussani says, let's take our traditions out of our backpack and put it on the table and discuss it. When you deny you have a tradition, you can't do that. And then finally, I'll just answer a question from my friend, Maura Shee, who works at the Witherspoon Institute in Princeton, just down the road from my home. And she says that she actually learned a lot of good things in her teacher training, focusing on assessments and how to write better assessments of classroom learning. And when she had to spell out her expectations for what students were going to learn in the classroom, that helped her as a teacher. And sometimes it seems like the classical education movement wants to throw out the baby with the bathwater about some things that are good in contemporary education. And I would just say, Maura, I agree with you. And Maritain and Education at a Crossroads says that there's been some good things that have come out of modern approaches to education. And not everything about measurement is bad. I think that when measurement becomes the end and when the only things we can know or talk about as significant can be measured, then that becomes the problem. But I would agree with you. I've learned a lot. I went to all of the teacher trainings I could go to at Princeton University, University of North Carolina, Yale. I love that stuff. However, my teacher training at Yale and Princeton and the University of North Carolina never talked about these foundational philosophical questions. What is a human person? What is moral truth? What's the role of training a student in character development or moral development? It's just that there's all these other questions that are left out of contemporary education. And my goal is to try to bring them back together. So I just want to thank you again, Tim, for all of your wonderful contributions, and thank the McGrath Institute for Church Life at Notre Dame for co-sponsoring this event, as well as the Pepperdine School of Public Policy. This video will be available on Scala's YouTube channel probably by tomorrow. And we do invite you to subscribe to Scala's YouTube channel. There's gonna be a couple of more events. We have two more great speakers lined up in June. Elizabeth Corey from Baylor University is gonna talk on learning and love. And Bill Damon, a psychologist at Stanford, is gonna talk about moral education. So please stay, if you don't already, subscribe to the Church Life channel on Church Life Journal on Facebook and Scala on Facebook. Please also do keep in mind that Scala is a nonprofit. We do our work through the support of the general public. And if you're so moved, we would welcome a financial contribution to keep these webinars coming your way. I really hope that this webinar has helped you think about education, because Scala really aims to examine the tradition of liberal arts education and explore the foundational questions about the human person in relationship to educational practice and pedagogy. So Dewey is such an important thinker in that, and also Luigi Giussani. Through activities like this, Scala is really trying to form a community of educators who share exemplary educational practices and care about human freedom in all fields of knowledge, and want to provide a transformative integrating experiences for students. As I mentioned, I first met Tim online through, I think, Twitter or Facebook, because we share this passion for educational philosophy and practice. And so all of you, please connect with me and Tim personally on Facebook and Twitter and the institutes that we represent, and stay in touch with us, because we really want, I really want Scala to become a movement of people who can examine this tradition and form communities that are living out this model of education and know how to unite people based on friendships and the sharing of ideas and the love of truth. Because ultimately, I believe that our hearts were made by God to know and to desire the truth, and that to go on this journey of education is a risk, but it's the most fulfilling risk you'll ever take. So once again, Tim, thank you so much for this wonderful webinar on experiential education in John Dewey. And I look forward to seeing all of you in more of Scala's Love of Learning live webinars. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.